This morning's scripture reading is from Psalm chapter 91, verses 1 through 2. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Acting United Methodist Church. My name is Wade. I'm lead pastor of the church. If you are a guest of ours today, thank you all for being here this morning. We also want to make sure we welcome those who are worshiping with us online, as well as those who worship with us quite regularly. We're glad that you're here because today is the day that the Lord has made, and you have chosen to rejoice and be glad in it. We're glad that everyone is here this morning. When you walked in, you did receive a worship guide, and in the worship guide, you'll see some information that we want you to be aware of. The first is this Lent opportunities sheet. We want you to be aware that now we are in the season of Lent, and there are specific opportunities available to you. One of the ones that's most timely is this Wednesday. Both Pastor Amy and I begin leading a Lent Bible study that'll take us through the next 6 weeks. You'll see information, more information about that on the back of the worship guide, and we want you to be aware of that and to sign up for it if you so choose to do so. You'll also see on the back some other information about a garage sale. I know the garage sale really needs some items. If you have items that you would like to donate, I know that they would love hearing from you on that, because all the proceeds for the Lord's Acre goes towards the all the proceeds for the garage sale goes towards the Lord's Acre in the fall for different projects in the church. You will also see an insert, this greenish, yellowish insert. This is about a schedule change that's happening with the Sunday morning schedule. Some of you may have received minutes from the ELLT, which is our executive lay leadership team meeting, based on an initial proposal with a different timeline. This sheet that you have in front of you is the real timeline. So moving forward, we want you to be aware of that as well. We want you to know that in every Sunday school class this morning, that there will be representatives from clergy as well as the ELLT, plus some of the people who initially proposed this plan, plus your Sunday school or small group leaders, will be in each of those groups or classes to discuss this. We want you to be aware of who the ELLT is. That's our executive lay leadership team. And so I believe their picture is going to be up here on the screen. Yeah, this is your representative body that was part of this consultation process. And so if you have any questions for me, I want you to email me. I'd love to visit with you. I have an open door policy. Would love to visit with you at any time. Also, if you want to visit with any of the ELLT, you'll see their email address. It's ELLT@actinumc.org. We want to be able to visit with you about this. In talking with different Sunday school class leaders and also different people throughout the church, one of the things we've tried to focus on is how are we going to talk about this? Some of you have already started talking about it. I want to invite us to enter into a covenant with one another if we can. And the covenant is multifaceted, but the first part of the covenant is that we covenant with one another that even though this may be a shock to some of us, we will not demonize those who have a different opinion on the change of Sunday worship. We're Christians. We don't have to demonize people who come at it from a different perspective, okay? So if you will covenant not to demonize those who come at it from a different perspective, will you say, I will? Okay, there are a few of you that are still holding out on that. And then also another covenant is that whatever questions that you have that you'll ask in your Sunday school classes or your groups, or if you want to find me after the service or Pastor Amy or Pastor Ben, will you covenant to share your concerns and your questions in those healthy environments and not wait to gossip in the hallway or on the phone or via text? Will you covenant to do that? If you will, say, I will. All right, and the last part of the covenant is this, and this is really cool because this is who we are as Christians. Will you covenant to just operate out of the spirit of love? If you will, say, I will. It's all good. I'm so thankful for all of you, and thank you for entering in that covenant. It's fun to be in covenant with one another as we grow with one another and as we go through changes and transitions with one another. So thank you all very much for entering into that covenant. And once again, if you want to talk to me, Amy, Ben, Chansoon, ELLTO, ELLT, find us. We would love to visit with you about that. In fact, if there are ELLT members here this morning, would you please stand up so we can direct everyone's attention towards you? All right, there's Patty right over there. And then also we've got some people. Oh, there's Randy right over there. And then we've also got a team that was part of the initial proposal of this, and we want to invite them to stand up. That's Bob and Bill and Pam right over there, yes. So if you have any questions, please reach out to them. Thank you all so, so much. Also, if you look on the inside of your worship guide, you'll see that some congratulations are in order. We don't know of any condolences. If we've missed something, please let us know, but we want to be sure to celebrate with those who are celebrating today. We want to celebrate with Dan and Pat Loomis, who recently celebrated their 51st wedding anniversary, so we can give God thanks for them this morning. Also, Dan and Linda Mulkey are celebrating their 19th wedding anniversary. We can give God thanks to them. And then there's one that was added that I actually saw on social media this week. Holly and Mike Moore are celebrating their 13th wedding anniversary. So we can give God thanks for them. So if you know those persons, please go up to them, congratulate them, give them a high five, and thank God for them at that moment. We're so thankful that everyone is here this morning. If you would, please stand, find someone you haven't said hi to, and greet them with the love of Christ.
As we prepare to move into a time of confession, would anyone like to confess to struggling with the time change this morning? I think my daughter would like to confess. You can't really explain it very well to a toddler. The good thing, though, is that before we've even confessed, before we've even sinned, before we ourselves are in need or even realize it, Romans chapter 5, verse 8 reminds us that God demonstrates his own love for us because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And that is the good news in which we prepare to confess our sins today. So hold on to that as you take a few moments and just pour out your heart to God in silence. And now with humble hearts, let us pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. At this time in the service, we lift up whatever joy or concern is on our heart today. And as we do that, we respond as a body, Lord, hear our prayers. So what can we pray for this morning? Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Gracious and loving God, as we take a deep breath and turn to you, we acknowledge that you are faithful and you are good and you are trustworthy and true. We are so thankful for the sacrifice of your Son, for your love that came down upon each of us, and for your Holy Spirit that fills this place. Breathe into our hearts today, Lord. Breathe into our hearts and help us to hear what we need today from you. We pray for Pastor Wade as he comes to give your message, and we ask that he would be a vessel of your Holy Spirit. He has words that we need to hear, God. And so we ask that you would use them as you need. Touch the hearts and open the minds of those who particularly need a word of encouragement and hope. We pray today for those that we have lifted up, those who are struggling, those who are in need. God, come and be beside them. You are already there, but show them your presence. We pray that they would see you and that they would know you, gracious God. And God, today we want to pray. We want to pray for our brothers and sisters who are worshiping in town in different locations. Especially want to pray for the Episcopal Church of the Good Shepherd and the First Christian Church of Granbury. May these churches feel an overwhelming dose of your Spirit today, God. May Christ be made known. May you be the center of their lives. Touch and transform their faith communities. Touch and transform our faith community, God, as we speak of change and of new possibilities for the future. We are open to how you are working. Give us a spirit to hear you, Lord, and to follow after you. We pray all this humbly in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you stand up and would you join affirming our faith through Apostles' Creed? Which has been coming down to us through our forefathers and foremothers, even the time of trial and struggle, they compass based on this foundation, they have always faithful. Would you go in? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I think I'm coming close onto my 3 years on staff here at Acton Methodist, and in my 3 years here, if there's one thing I've learned, it is that I love our greeters. I absolutely love our greeters. This morning, I understand at our main doors, we had 4 different people greeting. Apparently, some of them said that they had been promoted, and somebody else said they got demoted to another door, but we had 2 people at another door. We had somebody down at the education building, and I love that when you walk into our church, that there's always somebody there to smile at you. In the week, I love that we have people like Patty Williams and other people who are in the front office every day there to greet people with a smile, to answer the phones, and let people know that this is Acton Methodist Church, and that they're loved, even if they're just calling to ask what's going on. I love that throughout the week we have people who are ushering, who are working with our youth, who are doing all kinds of ministries at Rancho Brazos and Sandy Beach Community Centers. And on behalf of your staff, I want to let you know that we want to thank you. So if you look on the back of your worship guide, you'll notice that on March 27th, as a staff, we want to say thank you to the servant leaders in our church. So if you serve the church in any way whatsoever, if all you do is you pray for the church, we want you to know that we covet your prayers, that we appreciate your prayers, and that we want you to come on the 27th and to have a meal that you don't have to put any work into. We're going to set up the tables. We're going to get the food ready. We're going to serve you. You have to chew it, but we'll do everything else. Because we recognize that the ministry of this church is not the ministry of pastors. The ministry of this church is not the ministry of staff people who get paid to be here. The ministry of this church happens because of people who are here every day worshiping the living God and letting other people know that they matter not only to this church, but that they matter to Jesus Christ. And that our mission as a church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So I thank you this morning. As we prepare to give, would you go to God in prayer with me? Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. God, we give you thanks for each and every person here. God, I give you thanks for each person who is a servant in your church. Because God, I know that you have a call upon their lives to serve others. And God, I thank you for the ways that they listen to your call. God, as we prepare now to give back to you some of what you've so richly given us, we pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to you. And God, even this morning, we pray that you would open our wallets so that, God, we can be a part of all that you're doing. God, show us the way because we know that you are leading. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Ushers.
May be seated. Once again, it's good to see everyone here today. If you are with us most often, it really is good to see you again. And if you are a guest of ours today, we do expect that you'll have a great experience of the presence of the living God while you're here on campus with us today. So if you think back over the last year, we asked this question last week, if you think back over the last year, what changes and transitions have you gone through? What changes and transitions have you gone through, and what are you needing to walk with God through right now? Hopefully, if you were here with us last week or you watched online, I hope that's something that you have been wrestling with and that you have been struggling with and that you've been contemplating on, that over the last 12 months, what are all the different changes and transitions that you have gone through, and now what are the changes and transitions you are needing to walk with God through right now? And how is God working in and through you because of that? Today, what we're going to be focusing on is this question, what happens when my world changes? We're not going to spend the next few minutes you thinking about when my world changes, but when you ask yourself, what happens when my world changes? So how are you experiencing your world changing? I know for some of you, you are experiencing your world changing because you have just found out that your Sunday morning schedule and routine and relationships are going to be disrupted a little bit. Your world is changing. So if you came into church today thinking, well, no, my world's kind of nice and steady and there's nothing really going on, welcome to church. We're glad that we've introduced some change and transition into your life right now. Others of you, that's not a really big change in transition that you're really experiencing. You're just going to flow with it. Fantastic. But what you are struggling with is maybe a recent move that you've had. Your world has changed because of a recent move. Maybe your world has changed because of health. You've got something going on that you just found out about that no one else knows about, but that is a way that your world is changing. Maybe your world is changing because of family dynamics and fun. That you have stuff going on and you've had relationships or you've had conversations and now they're entering into a different season and your world is changing. Last week we talked about change in general. Today we're talking about change that's very personal. In fact, I heard someone say, we'll throw it up here on the screen, and I don't know who it's attributed to, but I think there's great wisdom in it. They said, when you go through a hard time, I pray. When I go through a hard time, I doubt. And I find that to be the case. I know that if you're going through a hard time, I can empathize with you. I can sympathize with you. I can come alongside of you. But I'm not experiencing the same thing that you are. But when I'm going through change, there's no more theory. It's fact. And we're not the first ones to go through this. Back in the Gospels, we understand the story of Jesus really ministering to his friends Lazarus and Martha and Mary. And I want to share this with you. This comes from John chapter 11. You have it printed in your worship guide. We'll also share it on the screen. But listen to how God is meeting people in the midst of their world changing. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we can all say, thanks be to God. Here's the prayer that I would love for us to pray together as we go into this time this morning. Mary and Martha's world had changed. We can learn from this. So here's a prayer that I would like to share with you that maybe we can all share together out loud. And the prayer is this: Lord, when my world changes and I am at my weakest, replace my prayers of if only you had been there with thank you for not leaving me. If this is a prayer that you would pray as we go into this time, would you all join together together? in praying. Lord, when my world changes and I am at my weakest, replace my prayers of, if only you had been there, with thank you for not leaving me. Amen. And may it be so. So as I'm thinking about the story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, and I'm thinking about when our world changes, when it's not just theory anymore, but when it's personal, then I look at the story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus and Jesus, and there's some things that I think are very meaningful to me. And I trust that they will be meaningful for you as well. And I want to couch them all in questions this morning, if that's okay. I have found that questions are like hooks. Statements are like bats. You don't really need to be told anything to where you feel like you're getting beat over the head with. But I trust that the Holy Spirit will work through these questions that might hook you, and you might see yourself in them. So the first question is this: when your world changes, do you know you belong to Jesus? I want you to think about the changes that you are experiencing right now in your world. When you're experiencing the change of a Sunday morning schedule change, when you're experiencing a change of health or family or a move, do you know that you belong to Jesus? And for some of us Christians, we may first think, well, I've known Jesus all my life. I was baptized as a baby and I was confirmed and yada, yada, yada. But do you know that you belong to Jesus? See, Mary and Martha, when they experienced the loss of their brother, whom Jesus loved, one of the things that helped them navigate the changes in their world was that they knew they belonged to Jesus. Mary and Martha and Jesus and Lazarus knew one another. Their relationship was secure. Their relationship was vibrant. Their relationship was ongoing. They didn't just have distant memories of one another, but they actually walked with one another. They spent time with one another. They spent time face to face with one another. And you know there is a huge difference between spending time with someone in an ongoing, intentional way and calling them a friend as opposed to having a friend on social media. I've got over 1,000 friends on Facebook. I have found myself in a room with some of them many times. And did you know that even though we are friends on social media, there's some of them that when we are in a room together, we don't know how to visit with one another? You may have encountered that as well. So in many ways, I think some of us have a friendship with Jesus that's almost like social media. We've got them, they're on our list, but when we're face to face, we don't know how to carry on a conversation. And we really don't know how to interact with one another. The relationship that Jesus had with Martha and with Mary and with Lazarus was not a social media relationship. It was a relationship where they understood that they belonged to one another and they poured into that relationship. I ask you today, as you experience change in your world, do you know that you belong to Jesus? That have you put your whole trust in his grace? Have you received him as your Lord and as your Savior and as your friend? Do you belong to Jesus in that you have an ongoing relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Or is your relationship something that you had once in the past and you hope that Jesus' relationship will propel you into eternity, but there's not much going on right now? It's really hard to navigate change in your world when you don't know where you stand with Jesus. Do you know that you belong to Jesus? In Romans chapter 8, we have this promise that we can all stand upon. And in Romans chapter 8, it's the Apostle Paul who's writing to the Christians in Rome, and he talks about the foundation of this relationship. That it's not enough just to know in your head that God loves you, but to know that you belong with the one who at just the right time broke into our world, into your world, so that you would know where you belong. So here are the words that Paul shared with the Christians that I think are good for us to hear this morning. I know it's good for me to hear as well. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. That is understanding who you are and to whom you belong. So let me ask you again. As you experience change in your world, such as starting on March 31st, you may have to contend with people who may think that the pew that you are sitting in is now their pew. Let's just acknowledge the change, okay? And I'm really looking forward to, on the 31st, seeing it from the platform, how y'all navigate those changes. As you consider that on March 31st, someone else may be sitting in your seat. Do you know that you belong to Jesus? And also, do you know the other person belongs to Jesus also? And as you experience change in your world with your health and with your moves and when changing relationships, do you know that you belong to Jesus? Because if you don't know that you belong to Jesus, your actions are going to reveal that you have no part with him. And Christ has adopted you, not because of your goodness, but because of his. Another question as you experience this change in your world, when your world changes, what promises do you stand on? So if the first question is, when you experience change, do you know that you belong to Jesus? I guess the next question, you could frame it this way, is when change happens, what promises do you stand upon? If you don't stand on any promises of your faith, if you don't stand on any promises of who Jesus is, if you don't stand on any promises of who you are in Jesus, that when change encounters your world, you are tossed to and fro like a ship on the waves of the ocean. You have no anchor. You have nothing to keep you firm and on a firm foundation. So what are the promises that you stand on? See, Mary and Martha and Lazarus, here's some of the promises that they stood on when they encountered Lazarus's death. The promise that they stood on is that they didn't just like Jesus, and they didn't just hang out with Jesus, and they didn't just think that Jesus was a charismatic guy. They understood that Jesus was the promised Messiah. That's the promise that they stood on. That when Lazarus died, and Martha said to Jesus, if you would have been here, he would not have died. She said that not just as a friend who was lamenting, but she said that because she was talking to the Messiah, the promised one, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What promises do you stand on? One of the great privileges I have is getting an opportunity to preside over different funerals for different people at different times. And one of the great things I love sharing are the promises that we stand on as Christians. And when we're in the middle of grief, we may not hear these. I know that. But there's still promises nonetheless that we stand upon. It's kind of like an affirmation of faith. We stand on these promises. These affirmations of our faith is what gives us our anchor, what keeps us within the lane. It helps us navigate these changes. And I want you to hear this promise that we can stand upon as our world changes, as some of us experience a little death. And every change and transition is a little death, something that we know has died or is about to die. And so many times we can get despondent, and we can sense that there may not be any hope, whether it's with a change of schedule or a change or a death of a loved one or a death of something that you've known. But I want you to hear these promises that we stand on as Christians that I hope you will not discount, but that you will reaffirm and that you will stand firmly upon as well. So whenever someone has died and we're celebrating their lives, these are some of the promises that I share. Jesus said, I am resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Those promises echo the story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus that death does not have the final word, including the death of what you have known. Another question to consider is this: when your world changes, do you know it is not the end of the story? When your world changes, do you know it's not the end of the story? When your world changes, do you know it's not the end of the story? When you're caught in the middle of change, it seems like it is the end of the story. You can't imagine something good perhaps coming out of it, whatever that thing is. When a change and transition happens, all you can see when you're in the middle of it is only what's in the middle of it. But I want to promise you something. I want to give you assurance that the death of Lazarus happened in John chapter 11. But did you know that there's a John chapter 12? That in John chapter 12, you have Lazarus who had been brought back from the dead, and you had Mary and Martha, and they were celebrating with Jesus, and their story continued. What a great witness they were throughout all of Christian history because of their resilience and faith through change. That when they were caught up in the middle, they could only see the pain of their loss of their brother. But on the other side of it, they saw a whole new world. I was visiting with Jordan. She is our Jordan Whitmore. She is our praise team leader at the 945 Modern Worship Service. And I was sharing with her about this, and I asked her if she would be willing to share part of her story. Because over the last 3 years, her world has changed quite a bit. And I asked her, I said, would you be willing to share your story like in front of people? And she said, no, I'll write it up and you can share it on my behalf. And I said, okay. She gets up and she sings in front of people all the time, but she didn't want to share that story, but she's okay with me sharing it. So as I share her story, imagine it's Jordan. And maybe you will hear your story in it also. But more importantly, maybe you'll hear God's story through Jesus. So here is Jordan's story. 3 years ago, I was traveling the world with my husband, and we were living in Austin, where we had been for over a decade, and I was working full-time as a musician. Life was good, and then my world changed. I had to say goodbye to one of the most important people in my life. I had to leave a city I loved, and we started over in Granbury, where my family was. My heart was broken over the losing my stepmom, who had been a mother to me since childhood, and I was also grieving the loss of a home and a city and friends that I loved. I went through the hardest season of my life. I became depressed, and I related to Mary and Martha when they said, Lord, if you had been here, things would have been better. He wouldn't have died. I wouldn't be hurting like this. I never doubted God was with me. I knew that he was, but I wondered why. Why didn't he intervene? Why did it have to go this way? Why couldn't he save us from this pain? It's 3 years later, and I still miss my stepmom. I still hurt over her loss. But I can honestly say that I love Jesus more now than I did then. And I trust Jesus more now than I did then. And there's a depth to my faith that hadn't been developed then. And I believe that's because I walked through the hard changes with him. And through these years, I've seen beauty come from ashes, and I've seen life come from death. From this pain, I wrote an album of worship songs that has been meaningful to others who have walked through grief and loss. It's been a humbling privilege for my offering, for my own journey, to be used to minister to others. God has blessed me with beautiful relationships that I would not have known, and that includes this church and the people and our band, who has been such a blessing in my life. There's been more music and opportunities and friendships than I can count. But the greatest blessing that has come from walking through my world changing is a deeper walk with him. Because ultimately, that is what is most important. When all this life fades away and I stand before him, I want to have known Christ and trusted him deeply. Jesus said that Lazarus' death and resurrection was for the glory of God. In the very next chapter, Jesus, knowing that he is about to face his darkest hour, says, "Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. Before this purpose, I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." I'm so thankful that Jesus walked through the hardest things for me. If Christ hadn't walked through the dark night of the soul and faced the most painful thing imaginable, you and I would have no hope. Praise God that he did. I long to be more like Jesus when facing the hard things in my life, and for my reaction and my prayer to shift from "save me from this" to "glorify your name through this." So what happens when your world changes? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, amen. As we prepare to leave this place, I want to invite you to Christian discipleship. I want you to invite you to have the faith that Jordan has modeled and the faith of Mary and Martha and what they have modeled. To not just experience change and transition like people of no faith, but how might this faith lead you to become more faithful? Whatever that change is that you're going through. The last hymn that we're going to sing is, "Are Ye Able?" God is able. Are you? Let's stand and sing as you consider what your response might be.
Are ye able, said the Master, to live as a covenant people who love God and love the world, and let people know that they not only matter to this church, but that they matter to Jesus Christ? Go forth in the name of the God who created you, the Son who saved you, and the Holy Spirit which empowers you to live with Christ. Amen.